Okay, I think we can start. Welcome back to our lecture series, Digital Sustainability Transformation of, by, and for the TUM. Together with Markus Sievert, I'm very happy that we can continue today with this series that is focusing on two central challenges of our time, digitalization and sustainability, and asking what is the role of the university and specifically also what is the role of the TUM when it comes to this, development and these targets. We want to look in this series on mutual opportunities and potentials, but of course also on risks, laws, problems and challenges coming out of this development, and want to see what the university and especially the TUM can do to promote, investigate and put sustainable digitalization into practice. If you have so far followed this series, then you might know that we, since this topic is very, very broad, we try to organize this in the series a little bit by looking at different pillars that are linked to digitalization and sustainability. And we focused on three of them, looking on economic aspects, on social aspects and environmental aspects. And the lecture today is located at the social pillar, so to say. However, we are absolutely aware that all of these topics have linkages to the other pillars as well. So today we want to focus on the topic gender justice, diversity and participation at universities and at the TUM. And of course, this is a topic with tremendous social importance, since it's not only important for intergenerational justice, but also if we're looking at the long-term effects, it's also important for intergenerational justice. However, as I mentioned, it is also linked to the other pillars. For example, with regard to economic development, we see a lot of studies showing that, for example, the diverse teams are very important if you want to promote progress, if you want to promote innovation, if you want to bring in new ideas into a company, into an institution. This is of crucial importance. And so the question we are focusing today is, I think, very, very important to look at, what about is the diversity and gender equality at universities like the TUM? What is the situation right here? And we are very, very happy that we have two real distinguished experts on this topic today with us. And I want to introduce them first. I want to first introduce Professor Claudia Peus. She's professor of research and science management here at the TUM and funding director of the TUM Institute for Lifelong Learning. And I'm very sure that she will say some words about this really interesting and new institution and institute here at the TUM. In her research, she focuses on questions of leadership development in the digital age, management of research organizations and diversity in organizations. So this is really at the heart of what we want to discuss today. She's a member of many various advisory boards, for example, the Board of Trustees of the Wertekommission. And she advises different organizations, businesses and science organizations on the topics such as leadership, diversity and talent management. And since 2017, she's our vice president for talent management and diversity here at the TUM. In 2020, she was named one of Germany's most inspiring women. So we are very, very happy to have you here today with us. And I'm also glad that Eva Sandmann is with us today. She is research associate at the chair of philosophy and philosophy of science at the Munich Center of Technology and Society, the MCTS. In her research and teaching, she is focusing on topics related to the aspects of ethics and responsibility in science and technology. And for our topic today, also very important, she serves since 2008 as gender equality officer at the TUM's Stabsstelle Chancengleichheit. And so she can give us, I think, also a deep insight into the situation here at the TUM. Welcome again. We are very happy that you're here. Before I hand over to you, I just want to say some organizational points. Each of you start with a statement on the topic, and then we planned a short discussion, maybe here on the podium, and then hopefully we can very soon open the discussion then also for the discussions for the participants out there. Markus Sievert will then also organize this discussion. But now, without any further ado, I will hand over to Professor Peus. Thank you again for being with us, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much for the kind introduction, and also Stefan Wurster and Markus Sievert, thank you so much for creating this lecture series. I have to say, when I found out about it, I was really thrilled, because I thought, wow, these are the topic of our times. And we all need to do something in those areas, right? At the end of the day, I think the big question of our time is, how do we create a society that's sustainable, but sustainable meaning economically, ecologically, and socially? And therefore, again, I'm very happy that the series exists and that there are the different aspects that play a role. I prepared a little bit of a presentation on, of course, diversity with a focus on gender equality, but also leading over to some more general considerations. And as you pointed out, Stefan Wurster, this is really close to my heart. I'm not only responsible for diversity strategy and their implementations at TUM, it's also in a research area of mine. And therefore, I have prepared a presentation that actually contains both aspects. I will start with research, and then I'll give examples on how we implement the strategy and the research at home. And before presenting that, you have to say that I'm very, very glad to be working together with Eva Sandmann and to have a super constructive dialogue on, you know, what's going on at home, how can we implement those kinds of things, and what do we need to take care of. And I do want to thank her at the stage for her really continued dedication and commitment to the topic. Thank you, Eva. It's a great pleasure. So let me give you a little bit of a background. I'll try to share my screen and show you my slides. Okay, actually, presentation mode is probably more suitable. Okay, so can you see okay? This is not the first slide though. I was too fast. So here we go. What's the situation? Well, as you probably have seen, there's been a lot of media attention on topic of gender equality specifically and diversity more generally.
I'm sorry, we can see the presentation mode. Maybe you can switch to the full screen. So because we also see your comments and everything.
Yeah, let's do this again. I'll stop it and then I'll do it again. Is it better now, right?
Perfect. Thank you.
Thanks. So right now, as most of you are probably aware of, there's a lot of discussion and interesting research on, well, guess what, the pandemic and the consequences of the pandemic. And unfortunately, there's quite a bit of research now pointing to the fact that the pandemic has hit female scientists to a greater degree than male scientists, because, well, mostly the explanation is that women do take on still a larger share of the childcare and the homemaking. And as obviously most childcare facilities and schools were closed, that much more of the burden was taken on by women, which then led, and there's interesting very clear data on the productivity of female scientists, showing that then, for example, the number of papers submitted to scientific journals dropped significantly, while the number of journal articles submitted by male scientists actually increased. So in a sense, the injustice probably increased due to the pandemic. Now, what's the situation? Just quick data. This is data from, as you can see, German-wide data on representation of women at different career levels. When we look at the students, it's almost 50-50, right? So people enrolled. At the doctoral level, this is a nice increase over the last 20 years. However, in short, the higher the rank, the lower the number of women. And that's largely true everywhere in the world, only the numbers differ, right? But the pyramid is still there. Now, why is that the case? There's obviously a ton of research, and I'll just summarize that in one slide, which is certainly not comprehensive. There's much more out there, but gives you examples. So there are reasons at all different levels. At the individual level, for example, women tend to underestimate their own performance. They tend to be a little less self-confident. They also tend to do less self-marketing, which is then sometimes also interpreted as having less to show. At the organizational level, we see that it's harder for women to get access to powerful networks and mentors. Sometimes even I've done an interview study with, in this case, managers, and some of them said, you know, I'm very happy to mentor younger people. The challenge is that when I'm seeing with a younger woman, involved in like confidential conversations, the gossiping starts. Which I thought is an interest. I mean, they have a point. So I think sometimes formal mentoring programs are important, because then you have a formal explanation as to why you are engaged in confidential conversations, for example. And then there's the societal level, which obviously has an impact on the lower levels. So yes, there is the issue of work-family conflict, which I talked about with regard to the pandemic. And the most important factor that really influences all others is stereotypes, right? All of us have stereotypes in our heads. We might not be aware of them. And in short, although there's a little bit of change, in short, the stereotype is still think manager, think male, or think scientist, think male. And that then has an impact, obviously, on how we attract talents, whom we recruit, and whom we promote to leadership positions. I want to give you little specific examples on research pertaining to those areas. So this is the talent management cascade. And again, I'll give you one or two studies at each level to highlight what the research is showing. So attracting talents. It's obviously important to attract talents in all of their diversity, and it's very important to TUM. We're working very hard at attracting even more talents from abroad, even more talents really in all the diversity, be it gender, be it nationality, age, etc. However, we also have to fight against existing stereotypes, and I want to show you a series of studies, or summary of a series of studies that we've done, that points to what can sometimes go wrong in trying to attract the best talents. So in short, we conducted a number of studies that showed that when you have a job posting that largely contains male stereotypes, women tend to not apply. Okay, so in short, if you, for example, advertise a job and you say, we need people who are really assertive, who are maybe dominant, who are very ambitious, these kinds of words might lead to the fact that women don't feel that they belong to the same degree as men do, and then they don't apply. And again, we've done, I don't know, something like 10 studies on this effect. And here are some examples of words that are in line with the male stereotype, which we call agentic, as opposed to in line with the female stereotype, which we call communal, okay? And interestingly enough, we've also done analysis of what is actually required, for example, in leadership positions. And more we see that a more a really balanced kind of profile is required, right? You have to be, yes, you have to be determined and you have to probably be outspoken, but at the same time, you really have to have responsibility for your employees and you have to be trustful and collaborative. Otherwise, you can't get very far. So in short, we're seeing that still today, especially leadership positions, but not only, are largely advertised in a way that's dominated by male stereotypes, which then leads to the fact that women don't apply. So we believe this is an important finding, as wordings in advertisement, and also the same is true for images, for pictures, can be changed very easily. And we show, in this case, collaborating also with scholarship organizations, that when those scholarship organizations change the way they advertise, it changes the number of women who actually apply. So that's one example, and I'm happy to send you the papers that are mentioned here. So maybe let's move to the next step. Let's say ideally you did the right thing. You have job ads or postings that are really, let's say, diversity embracing. What happens now when we select talents, when we recruit talents? Well, a lot of the time, recruitment still looks like this, right? The psychologists say it's the similarity attraction paradigm. So in other words, people who are similar to us, we believe they're more competent. Sociologists speak about homosocial reproduction. So in other words, same phenomenon, right? We tend to choose people who are just like us because we attribute competence to them, we like them more, and therefore if we don't make a conscious effort, we tend to hire those. And there's a pretty well-known study here in the area of academia, and you can read obviously from the title that here science faculty biased favored male students in an experiment. And this experiment was a field experiment. So real professors were sent fake CVs of either male or female applicants. And interestingly enough, as you see from this slide, the male applicants, which by the way had the same CV as the female ones, right? Only a different name, were attributed higher levels of competence. They were attributed higher levels of higher ability. The faculty said they were going to mentor these people to a higher degree, and they also offered them more money, roughly $5,000 more a year for the male student. And that's, I think, a very interesting, important experiment, because again, the CVs of the applicants were the same, just a different male or female first names. So there's something to be done, and I will speak more about what we are doing at TUM and what can be done in a second. But I do want to go to the next level, which is leadership, right? Exercising leadership, and also who gets promoted to leadership. And here, this is these are data from an interview study that we conducted as part of a project funded by the German Ministry of Education and Research. And we asked professors in this case, and only professors in the STEM disciplines, what are requirements in your role? And in short, the study reveals that if you're on the track to becoming a professor, you need those agentic, those male stereotyped qualities, right? You have to be assertive, you have to be really ambitious, you have to really, you know, find your own way, you have to do a little bit of self-marketing, you have to assertively show that you know what you're doing and that you're an expert in your field. However, when you have a leadership role, in that case, you are a professor, the interviews clearly show you need more communal attributes, right? You have to find collaborative ways of, you know, setting up research projects with colleagues, you have to mentor your team members, help your PhD students grow, et cetera, et cetera. So it's an interesting shift in requirements. And I think the requirements that are needed to fulfill the professorship, that role, need to be on recruiters' minds a bit more than they might be right now. I think right now we are looking, you know, at the agentic qualities to much higher degree than we are looking at the communal qualities. And that again has implications for who gets hired in a selection process. Final study on leadership here. The question is, now you are in a leadership position, right? Ideally you were chosen, and what happens when you show different leadership styles? The study shows that in this case, the difference between male and female leaders in the eyes of the raters, so who should they rate, who should be promoted or who's suitable for promotion, there's no difference when they are autocratic, but when they're transformational, which is a very desired leadership style, the men are again favored. Okay, so in a sense they get a bonus for being transformational leaders, the women don't. Okay, so it's an example of having different standards. So with that background, I want to show you a little bit of, or give you some information on the practical implications, right? What can we do about this and what are we doing at TUM? So in order to have job ads that are not biased, we developed a tool that's called the Gender Decoder. Essentially, it's an online tool, which you can find under that website. And anyone, any art organization can copy and paste their job ad and then gets a score on how biased this score, this job ad is, and suggestions for adapting it. Okay, and it's, again, it's, well, open access, free to anyone. And I do hope that more and more organizations will use it, because it's a very quick and easy tool to use. And I think very helpful in trying to actually attract diverse talents. And by the way, of course, we're trying to install it at TUM to a greater extent. So also we've written extensively about how to select people in academia. In short, the research shows the more structured the recruitment process, the more independent raters involved, the lower the degree that biases influence the decision, okay? What that actually means, obviously, is detailed both in our writings, and we also convey that to colleagues, be it professors, be it science managers, in workshops at TUM. Here we also came up with a Handreichung, with a guideline for gender-sensitive recruitment, which again was developed as part of a BMBF-funded project, which again is available to anyone. And finally, we have developed a lot of leadership trainings, for example, on how you can actually deal constructively with resistance in gender equality work. We have also developed training modules for those different aspects that are important for leaders, right? How do I lead individual employees? How do I set up teamwork effectively, especially when I have a diverse team, etc. And again, they can be found on our website. Now at TUM, and this is very new this year, and you can see the upcoming dates, we introduced many more trainings for professors and science managers at TUM, in which we want to support our colleagues to really find the best talents and recruit the best talents in all of that diversity. We also help them get a better understanding in, for example, in diversity basics. What is it actually? Why should I care? How can I implement diversity in my teaching, for example, done by Polere Media Didaktik under the title The Normal Student. What's normal anyway, right? And we also speak about intercultural aspects under the topic Lost in Translation. So there's much more coming up, and if there are further ideas, we are happy to take them on as part of the TUM Institute for Lifelong Learnings program. And with that, I would like to thank you and look forward to the discussion and to questions. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I will hand over to Markus. He will organize the discussion, but a very, very interesting talk. Thank you. Thank you so much. But I think we will continue first with Eva Sandmann and then start with the discussion here and then with the audience.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'll try to keep it a little short so we have more room for the discussion. And I will not present a PowerPoint. I think we saw the facts and kind of have an idea of what we're talking about within the TUM and on the subject itself. Thank you for the introduction and thank you for the possibility of addressing the topic. I'm just reading that you can only see a black screen. Is that anything I can change? Everybody else can see me okay? Okay, so I'll just continue, sorry. So what does gender or equal opportunity really mean to me, or mean to me as the as it comes to the work that I've done as the gender equality officer in the last years? Actually, it's a change of perspective. Just like Claudia said, all the facts are quite clear. If we look at the research, I think there's no doubt about it, but how can we really make the change? How can we take a step further? How can we tackle the stereotype behavior? How can we go into self-reflection in all our processes and really make the change? And I think the way to go is to inspire, to stick to your personal values or stick to your ideas that you want to establish within the university, and not of course, the respectful interaction within the university is also a very important fact. I mean, we have a discussion on different levels and different career levels. How does that go into play with the different treatment of people? So I think that has something to do with the honesty, of course, and the possibility to speak up to your values. I'm often asked why is diversity important? And Claudia just said, or Stefan said it before, of course, it's diverse teams add a greater value. And coming from the having a biological background, I think the value of biodiversity is quite clear, especially on a universal scale. But coming into smaller teams, coming into team play, as often it's not so clear. So taking a close look into your closer team or in your work surrounding, what is really the added value within different perspectives, and why does that improve research, and why does it improve even the way you look at lecture or you look at teaching? I think it's very important, especially if you were looking at the new legal framework within Bavaria. Sustainability, of course, has the same issue of being used as a buzzword or being used for almost anything. And I think it's very tricky to address it a way that it's still interesting and everybody wants to pick up the message. And now it comes to my work as a gender equality officer. Within all our decision-making processes, within the governance structures, really look into the detail and see how we can make all the differences to change the topic within the university, and using the university role within society to change the topic on an even greater scale. I think that's definitely the idea. Of course, there's many different measures. Like Claudia said, there's a lot of issues within teaching, of course, the way you integrate it into your discipline. Gender and diversity always has a, or quite often has a large impact within the research itself. So I think that's something the university can kind of go into depth, and not just in disciplines where it has tradition, but even within medicine, for instance. I guess nobody will discuss that in a different point of, in a different aspect, but it's just not, does not play such an important role in research. So yeah, it's that self-reflection idea to the topic that's important, I guess, in all the different departments, and of course in all our new governance and the whole transition process. So hopefully, I think it's good if it doesn't stick the way it has been politically implemented in the past, but even maybe it kind of reaches another climax. And yeah, it should be something that goes into the heads of every member of the university, and not just with the decision making, but on a broad level within the whole university. That's the short statement. I hope you get the idea of the work within the Gender Equality Office. If you have any question, of course, there's the homepage, and I always have an open door and an open email account for all the questions or anything, any help that's needed on a different level. That was it in short. Marcus, I think it's your play, right?
Thank you. Thank you very much for the presentation, Professor Peus, and also for the comment by Eva Sandmann. So I invite now everybody in the audience to send us questions via the Q&A function so that I can collect them and then put them forward to our speakers of today. So maybe I give you time to write your questions in the Q&A function, and start with a question of my own, maybe as an icebreaker. And one of the key sentences from the talk that I took with me for Ms. Peus was the more structured the process are, the less biases we can find. Now, if we think about processes that are set up in the university, let's start with kind of like BA and MA commissions, for example, or doctoral commissions and committees, or professor finding commissions, etc. Would you say kind of like how well is Germany or the TUM situated in these kind of settings? Do we have really good structured processes? Are maybe, you know, the Anglo-Saxon model or like the Scandinavian model might be, you know, better models? Or what? How do you see it? And are there also then for Eva Sandmann, are there kind of like, you know, steps that are will be taken to have a more structured approach, maybe also at the TUM level?
Thank you very much for the question. Yes, structure is important. And I think, so number one, I think the TUM has really made great progress in hiring more female professors. If we look at 2009, roughly 9% were female. Now we're speaking about 30%, roughly. I should be clear, at the 10-year track, level, we look at 38% female professors. I think that's a great success. And I think the structured model to professorship is probably one that's very suitable. Are we there? No, I think there's a lot to be done. I think what I see is there is a lot of variance in how structured the process within search committees are, for example. And we want to support our colleagues who are members or leaders of search committees in being aware of diversity and in helping them set up a very structured process. There are some search committees that I think are very structured. Others are not so structured. I think that's an important finding. So in short, we will provide, you know, guidance and training for colleagues. And we are also working on having more standardized descriptions in job ads, because right in the talk, I pointed out that the way both a position and also an organization is described, the attributes that are used has an impact on how much do men and women and or talents in their diversity more generally want to apply or not. Just not because they don't think they can be successful, but because they think I don't belong here, right? If I only see, like, let's say, pictures of white men, or I am not white or whatever, maybe I think, well, I just don't fit in. And so we're aware of that and trying to change that. And finally, I think I can speak for the board of management that we are taking the issue really seriously. And we do look at lists, and Eva Sandmann can also report from her work and from the Senate's work. We no longer accept, you know, lists in which no woman has played any role. And if for example, all the candidates who are invited are male, we do ask questions, and we have rejected lists which we didn't think considered the full pool of talents. So yes, we take it serious, but there's more to do.
And maybe just to add to that, I think, I mean, you mentioned training and unconscious bias training within the commission's work. And I think the main difference is that it's a must do and not only an option. I think this is really kind of the turning point. If you want to be politically active within the commission work, then there is a must do for you to get yourself equipped and to read into the research. I think that's really kind of a change of mindset. And again, just like mentioned, I mean, we're the new governance structure within the talent management and diversity within the board of management and within the school system. I think that's also something that's quite showing that there's more resources for the topic and more people involved, of course, has a greater gain for the topic in the end.
Maybe if I can extend what Eva is saying, to, as not all of you are involved in the school transitions, in the future, in every school, there will be the Office of Vice Dean Diversity and Talent Management. And that's new, because that position was newly created, and the person holding that position will be part of the executive board of the school. So in a strategic decision-making position, and I think that signals to you how serious we're taking the issue.
This immediately, you know, picks up on one of the other questions that came up from the audience. You know, kind of like, can you add some more concrete examples on what it specifically means to embed equal opportunity in the organizational structure in this period of transition? Kind of like, was one of the questions, and you mentioned one now. Maybe you can highlight one or two more. Not sure. Maybe Eva starts.
Or... Do you want to go first, or do you want to?
Well, I would maybe highlight, because I think that's some homework, because it is not so obvious within the communications as it could be, the topic itself, to be sure that everybody knows where to turn to if you're not happy with your situation, or with the, if you feel, if you have a discrimination topic, which place to turn to, how can you address it, and how can it be helped, or how can you be helped? I think that's something that we are in transition right now. And I think within our communication, we have to pick it a little, it needs to be picked up.
So yeah, in short, I mean, we have implemented diversity very visibly at different levels of governance, right? Not every university actually has a board member who's in charge of diversity. So not every university has a vice president for. That was a very important signal that to send up. Then the vice deans, obviously will have the women's and or equality representatives in each school. And then again, as said before, in terms of the towards having more diversity embracing job ads, we will train or offer trainings for colleagues who are on selection committees and also in the position to recruit more generally, and also promotion committees. And finally, yeah, at the board level, we are taking the issue very seriously.
And of course, the resources. I just wanted to mention the resources that are put into the topic, because we did not mention the family service or all the different measures that are possible in the dimension of child care or elderly care. I think, again, we're doing a job there, but it's still room for more, of course, with the situation, child care, and the situation within the pandemic Claudia talked about in the beginning of the presentation. But that's definitely the topics or the fields.
I would have another question, because it directly relates, I think, to this one, to the topics that we discussed now. And then I have Stefan Wurster on my list as well afterwards. So one of the questions also from the audience was that Eva mentioned the challenges of transition, you know, in the current zeitgeist. And so what support do department students, professors typically ask for in order to improve gender balance or participation on campus?
I think, like I was just saying, the family service would be one of the topics that at least are addressed quite often. And of course, also, there's a margin between discrimination and maybe personal unhappiness with situations. So a lot of times it is a consultation to the private situation, or also for the career situation that maybe that they're not so happy with, and they want to take a closer look if it has a gender dimension to it or not, or gender diversity dimension. Those are the topics that I'm confronted with most.
Maybe just a quick add-on. Can you observe a change during the kind of like the corona pandemic and the pre-crisis time? So is there a change of importance in topics and issues that come up?
Well, it's kind of obvious that that there's not as many people within the university. So of course, there's not as many interactions within the university, but it comes to a cyber dimension of the topic, which is also just as realistic and definitely needs just as much consultation, but on a different level, maybe. But yes, there's a change, of course.
Thank you. Then, Stefan, you can ask your question directly, I think.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for both very interesting talks. I have one general question. The aim of this lecture is, in a way, that of course, also to evaluate a little bit also what is the situation at the TUM. We also heard some ideas, some results here, but maybe it's a very tricky question, but if you evaluate the TUM in comparison to other universities of the same liga, so to say. Where do you see, what do you see, what might be the big advantages at the TUM? Where is the TUM really performing already very good? And where do you maybe see the biggest challenges that are still there, having also in mind, of course, that it's a technical university, so maybe the comparison should be the fairest, also compare it with other technical universities. So what would you say, where is the, if you should evaluate the TUM, where do you, what would you say, what is the situation right now? This is my first question. And the second one is, since I'm very interested in this long-term dimension, yeah, and we know, of course, this topic has immediate impact for now, for the generation right now. But it's also very important to set up structures to have not only effect here and now, but also in the coming decades. And for this, of course, institutional change, institutional settings are very important. And I would like to know a little bit more, what would you say, what are here the most important aspects for a university like the TUM? Because, of course, there are also different models you can implement here. You can try to centralize this issue, for example, yeah? Or you would say, no, it's better to decentralize it, put it on the level of, on a decentralized level. So I would like to learn a little bit more, or what are your ideas here regarding this long-term institutional change that is maybe needed to make progress with regard to this.
So maybe I'll start, and if I can add, I'll start with your second question, institutional long-term perspective. We all know from research and sometimes experience, changing cultures takes at least 10 years, probably longer, right? So we do need, you know, a long-time dimension. In terms of the question, what needs to be, you know, bottom-up versus top-down, I think we need both at a university. I do think we need, you know, top management needs to be committed to the issue, and I can assure you we are. I think top management also needs to assess, you know, overall, what's the general strategy, which obviously we did and we are doing it as terms of excellence initiative, etc. So there needs to be, you know, an overarching strategy, but I think it can't be too fine-grained, because of course every school is different and every topical area is different. Yes, of course we have, you know, the stereotypes in, let's say, mechanical engineering are probably different than in political science, okay? So we have to take that into account, and therefore I think it's so important to have this governance in which there is a, you know, a central person, you know, being both the vice president, diversity and talent management, and the TUM-wide gender inequality representative, and then also have the vice deans at the school level,
Now the connection is really breaking down. I hope it's not mine, but I see the other pictures moving.
Also, I think we lost this connection, so maybe Eva, you can jump in then.
at least I'll try. Well, I think Claudia also already said both bottom up and top down are important. I guess that's part of the work that we're doing right now, the structural process, top down on one hand, and to gather all the, I would say, valuable seeds that are throughout the university. I would always compare it with a big branch of a tree. I think this can only work if it's a mindset topic throughout the university. So I think definitely the people need to be inspired and need to have the freedom to really go into the topic, right? So that's, I think, the TUM is doing quite a good work supporting both top down and bottom up. There's processes, there's again located resources to inspire to pick up the topic. I think that's done quite well. Of course, our improving internationality poses some challenge because being more international means different cultures, different values in this dimension as well. And to adapt to this situation still needs some time, again, in the mindset of the people, I think. Claudia is back, so maybe you want to pick up on your words.
Sorry, I think I just heard you say that there's, you know, support for top down, bottom up. I think that's, as I said before, very important. And for example, we have a, I don't know if you mentioned that, the gender diversity incentive fund, which so the schools were able to apply for supporting money, which I think is a great idea. And there were a lot of interesting initiatives that arose from it. So those are important. And pertaining to the question, where do we stand? Well, the question is obviously the level of comparison, right? I think within Germany, we are doing pretty well. We are, especially with our, you know, early introduction of tenure track, as I said before, we have 38% of tenure track professors are female, and more than 40% are hired from abroad. I think these are good starting points. And now we have to make sure that those diverse talents who were hired also have the opportunity to really unfold their full potential at TUM. And I think overall, many good things are happening. However, yes, I mean, now every now and then, if I can tell you more about that, there are still, let's say, stereotypes at place, right? And for example, recently I saw a lecture series in one school on a pretty generic topic, or I should say a broad topic. And out of, I think, 30 people giving a presentation, there were 30 men. And that surprises me. I mean, I think most colleagues are aware of the facts, and most colleagues are aware of that we need diversity. By the way, also diversity meaning, you know, backgrounds, culture backgrounds, but also styles of thinking, etc. However, we are, of course, embedded in a national culture, and also in a Bavarian culture. And that sometimes brings certain stereotypes with it. And we have to transform, and Eva alluded to that, we are by now, I think, a very, very international university, but there are areas in which we need to fully embrace that international spirit and fight some cultural stereotypes that are more at the national level. For example, the, you know, think engineer, think male, think leader, think male. That stereotype is stronger in Germany than it is, for example, in the US, or we know some cultures in which engineering or natural sciences like physics are much more female dominated than that's the case in the German context. So there's more to be done.
Another question is with regard to kind of like changes that we can see or observe, was kind of like whether you would see that the younger generation of men, or also kind of like, is there a cultural change about like gray old white men, that they also kind of like have a stronger awareness to these issues, hire women also more often? Is there, can you support this, something like that, in your data, either a cohort effect or like a difference in behavior, or is it, you know, still kind of like women that push women issues?
Luckily, it's not only women pushing women's issues. Internationally, you probably, you know, of the He for She project, right? So it's also deliberately men, which is obviously very important. My experience is that usually people, men and women, who've been, you know, in other cultural settings and have experienced many, you know, diverse talent, again, women, but also, you know, non-whites, etc., in leadership positions, for them, it's obviously much more natural, and they don't tend to expect, you know, someone in a leadership position to necessarily be a white older man. And again, you know, stereotypes a lot of the times unconsciously influence what we think. I was sometimes shocked when I moved to the US, when I heard, for example, radio interviews, and they introduced someone as, you know, a wonderful researcher, professor such and such, that my first thought was this going to be men. But after experiencing a couple of times that, you know, that wasn't the case, that changes your stereotypes. So I think people made that experience, then again, might have different expectations, which then helps. But I also have to say that, you know, change is not given. So thinking that, you know, there's going to be a younger generation and just sort of by itself, there will be a more diversity embracing culture, that is just not true. I think we have to keep at it. And at the societal level, at least, there were tendencies to even be more traditional when it comes to gender roles. So we have to be keenly aware of what's going on there.
Maybe I would like to add to that, that at least I have the feeling that it's more of the individual experience of the people, no matter how old or what color they are. It's more their individual background, or having daughters, having younger kids that come to the kind of glass ceiling or touching issues like that, that makes them aware, maybe on a different level.
Yeah, thank you very much. Then I have two questions that focus more on the research that Professor Peus presented, and maybe combine them. So the first question from the audience was kind of like, how does talent actually get lost between like the communal level and the other category of words? And then the other question was, what would you recommend to women that rather feel like having communal values and then see, you know, job posts or job descriptions or rules of the game that, you know, are antagonistic to this description? Would you then recommend them to change their behavior or kind of like, you know, pretend to be different, or other, how would you advise young women on this strategy here?
So yeah, to the first question, how does talent get lost? Well, the problem is that stereotypes get activated in the heads of both people who are potential applicants and also people who are on the recruiting end. So by stressing, you know, the agentic stereotype, which is in line with the male stereotype, you know, assertive, dominant, aggressive, etc., the image we have of the person who fits that position is male dominated. And therefore, and this is what the studies show, we have the effect that both women are in a sense deterred. They think, oh, I don't fit in, so I won't apply. And we have some brand new research data showing that it also makes a difference in recruiters' minds, because they also then picture, you know, the ideal candidate as more, well, described by male attributes, let's say, and there. So the question, second part, I guess, of your question, what can women do? I guess the advice is don't get deterred. You know, do, even if you think, well, maybe I don't really belong there, try. So I can really only encourage you to, you know, apply for scholarship programs, for, you know, career development programs, for positions, even though you think there is no way I will fit in. I can honestly share, the first time I applied for a professorship, I was really young, and I thought there is no way they will even invite me. And luckily, in this case, a female professor said, no, I want you to apply. And after a long conversation with her, I did, and I ended up almost getting it. To my own surprise, and the experience was really valuable. So do apply, don't get deterred.
And I would like to add to that, ask the gender equality officer involved, because in a lot of these processes, there is a legal framework, and there is supporting measures, so take them.
Maybe to add on that, also a question, what, you know, what services are out there? There's a question from the audience, is there a nursery area available on campus? for parents that are studying? And maybe to add on top of that, what are future initiatives that you plan? Or let's say, if you would envision as like the best future, what would you like to see in the next years to happen at the TUM, Eva?
Well, if you mentioned childcare, I guess we're within a city where this topic is really hot because there's just not enough resources or enough place for the kids, and especially for the researchers coming to the TUM. They don't really realize, coming from maybe from a different part of the world where childcare is not such a big issue as it is within Munich. I mean, so I guess one vision would be, of course, there's a possibility to fulfill everybody's needs coming to the TUM and to seeing if they find the right space for all of the members of the family, of course. Also finding jobs in the sense of dual career is something very important for the recruitment process in general, or even to make the TUM attractive. I guess we didn't touch on that project, on that topic at all, but kind of finding the right place for all family members, since the family dimension can be looked at a little closer, and we would have to find ways to arrange that as the university or support it if possible. At least that's the vision.
Professor Peus, you want to add something? Or
I think in the excellence proposal we stated we wanted to be the most attractive German technical university for women, and I would extend the women for diverse talents, so talents and all their diversity, so really people from all backgrounds and all different, you know, nationalities, ethnic backgrounds, etc., etc. I think that should be the goal. We should do our very best to not only attract and recruit them, but then again give the opportunity that each and everyone can really unfold their full potential and also, you know, specialize in the areas in which they want to and receive the support that they need. And I can assure you that we're working really hard towards that.
Thank you. I have one more question from the audience, at least. And then Stefan Wuster has also raised another question. So can we talk about must-do criteria that commission project must meet? Are there guidelines available? Is there any, you know, help on kind of like must have criteria when it comes to diversity?
So you're asking diversity overall or selection processes?
It's not specified here. Okay. In the question. Maybe pick one where it fits better to you.
Okay, so in short, I think this is in line with organizational research overall. If there is no top management support for any issue, you're not going to go very far. Okay, so top management support is crucial. We do have that at home. Then implementing it in the governance is crucial. And as Eva also brought up, I think we are making a wonderful step now in creating this new position, Vice Dean, Talent Management, Diversity in every school. And that's mandatory. No school can say we don't want it. Okay, I think that's very important. So those are, I think, must-haves. I think offering childcare options is a must-have for any modern university. And I do think that having a lot of offerings in the area of how do I deal with diversity, especially for people in leadership decision-making positions, is really important. Both, and of course, the talents we're attracting, but I think both levels, right? We can't embrace an approach to training that in the literature is sometimes called fixing the women, right? Or you could say fixing the diverse talent. So it can't be the right approach to train them to be more like men, which, by the way, is what some organizations actually do, to my shock. That's not the right approach, but I think we rather have to help everyone, and therefore leadership is crucial to create this culture and those structures and processes that enable all of us to unfold our potential. So I think that's crucial. And then obviously, as Eva said, unfortunately, in any big organization, there are always going to be individuals who don't fully meet our criteria, who don't fully embrace the spirit of diversity. And we need to then know, so individuals who feel they've not been treated right, they need to know where to go and they need to receive support. And we obviously have places to go, but I'm going to be honest and say we are sharpening that area. We're making it clear who can turn to which person, and we'll provide more support in the future.
Thank you. Eva, you want to add something?
Maybe just the coaching as a topic, coaching possibilities, not only within the career, but in different or for different stages within the career of the academia. So just all kinds of coaching possibilities, I think, would help.
Thank you. Stefan, your question.
Yeah, I just wanted to bring in this other big issue we have in this lecture series, digitalization. And my question is, of course, what do you think, what is the effect of this? Yeah, we see this now, it has a huge effect for the university. Digitalization is a big issue. One could argue, for example, that we talked a lot about stereotypes, that this is an area that there are heavy stereotypes that maybe, are there a lot of hindering factors maybe coming in one's mind when you say, okay, we have now more digitalization at the university level. So what is your impression or your idea regarding this linkage or not linkage to the question of gender equality, diversity? What do you think? Is this more a challenge or is it more a chance? Or what are the conditions to make it more a chance than a challenge?
Thank you. I think that's a really important question you're asking. As with any technology, it's a lot of opportunities, but it's also risks, right? One thing that does concern me, I have to say, is the fact that right now, worldwide, the majority of people who are developing, you know, algorithms and developing technology and are behind digitization are white men. And that's really evident everywhere. And if we look at, you know, the entrepreneurs and the CEOs of the big tech companies, there's not that much diversity. And obviously we all know about the reports that there is sexism in Silicon Valley to a great extent. So I think we really, really have to be careful in using the potential that digital technologies provide to really include diverse talents in the development. So that's crucial. Because then hopefully the technology can really unfold the potential and help all of us, right? Help us have structured processes, less bias in hiring, for example, etc. But I think, again, this is not a given, right? We've seen that to build on the example of recruitment processes, right? We thought maybe, wow, if an algorithm picks people, we'll have no bias, right? And then guess what? The Amazon example clearly showed, no, we did have more bias even, right? Because developers were, well, in recruiting developers, women were sorted out and non-whites were sorted out. So we have to be very, very careful what the input is, for example, that we give, what kind of data we feed our algorithms on. And again, I think we need a really inclusive approach to developing digital technologies.
And maybe to add just a side effect, we are now having a Zoom lecture, right? And the technical possibilities that are just not equally distributed. And so it is kind of, it's up to your technical equipment if you take part in the communication. And that's maybe also some selection process within this attempt to kind of keep communication flowing.
Yeah, thank you. So I would invite the audience to hand in more questions if there are any. In the meantime, maybe I take the opportunity to ask another one. And it's a little bit more kind of like maybe like experimental in a sense, because Professor Peus, you also mentioned like the difference between skill sets that are required at the previous stages becoming professor and then at later stages, right? And in big companies, we see like now a trend for creating co-leadership positions, because we all know that kind of like the higher you move up in the university ranks, the more challenging the job gets, different skill sets required, teaching, organizational, researching, et cetera, et cetera. So what do you think about having like creating co-professorships or 50-50 professorships where teams can lead research units in order also to combine different skill sets?
I think it's a really interesting idea. And by the way, I learned there's an area even within our university in which that's actually not uncommon, and that's architecture. I was very surprised to learn that. And I think it's amazing to see those examples. The interviews I conducted with colleagues, but those were more sporadic. Most of them were very happy with the situation because they did, they held their professorship and on the side there took care of the architecture office and said there's benefits for, both sides. The students, of course, also benefit from the work being done in the office, because it's obviously very practice related. So there is an example in medicine even, which is maybe not the most diversity friendly discipline overall. I think it's interesting. I think we have to clearly examine though which factors increase the likelihood that it's successful, because of course also from business organizations there are examples of successful co-leadership. There are also examples of not successful co-leadership, and of course unfortunately the pandemic has given us a prominent example of falling back to stereotypes when we look at what happened as SAP. So yeah, interesting idea, but again, we have to look at it closely before we experiment with it more broadly, I think.
Thank you. If there are not more questions, maybe we can close with the last one from the audience. The question is kind of like much has been done and that the TUM over the last 10-20 years came a long way and is already leading in many ways, but that there are also still steps to be taken. So the question is, how long do you expect the transition to real gender justice and diversity, equal opportunities will take? Maybe a good closing question also.
No more than 10 years.
Okay. Yeah, I write this down.
I love your optimism. No, I think, again, it's a continuous process. I hope in this case, we will also see exponential trends. Not only in other areas, which we have seen in the past, but if we have exponential trends here, then we'll be fast. Research shows once we have roughly a third of the previous minority on board, then the stereotypes change. And then, it's a lot easier to have a cultural transformation. So I think we're on a good track.
Mm-hmm. Then we leave it at this very positive note, exponential growth in gender equality in less than 10 years. And there we have our quote for our social media posts following this talk. Thank you very much, Professor Peus. Thank you very much, Eva Sandmann, for this great insight, both research, practical issues. I think it was a really interesting combination, you know, and combining in-depth research knowledge and kind of like practical aspects and where we stand at the TUM. So thank you very much. I think Stefan will also have a short thank you note.
I cannot add a lot more. Thank you again. Very interesting aspects. I would all of the participants also invite, you mentioned this, to look at your home pages. I would also once again stress, we didn't talk about this Institute for Lifelong Learning. All of you look at this very interesting on the homepage. It's really interesting. We didn't talk that much about also these job opportunities for that are or these opportunities to develop with regard to scientific researchers. We talked a lot about this career path to professorship, but as we all know in our system, especially in the German system, not all can become a professor, and also trying to find ways that our scientific system is not producing a lot of most of them find something, but there are obviously a lot of problems also in mid and long term problems produced by our system as it is in Germany. So, and I think this new institute is really with the program behind it is really an interesting and very helpful institution. So maybe Professor Peus, you might also want to say something at the very end regarding this. But I would all of you invite to visit the homepage here and all the other pages you mentioned, of course, too. So thank you again for the very interesting talks and the discussion.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to present what we're doing, right? And hopefully inspire others to go along. Yes, and thank you also for pointing to the TUM Institute for Lifelong Learning, which offers, as you can refer from the name, various opportunities to learn a lifelong. So opportunities for all members of TUM, also for externals, but for the internals, be it professors, be it postdocs, be it science managers. So I invite you to check out the website and hopefully you find something that interests you. Also, if you don't find something that interests you, but you think it's needed, let us know. So with that, I would like to say thank you. And I look forward to meeting some of you at the next opportunity, wherever that may be. Thanks.
So then, final words from my side. There's no lecture next week. I invite all the audience out there to join us in 2 weeks with Thomas Auer presenting and giving a talk. He's professor for building technology and climate friendly construction at the TUM, and he kind of like will introduce then the ecological dimension of sustainability with his talk about a roadmap for decarbonization of universities. So this is the advertisement, and then I wish all of you out there a very nice evening. Stay safe. Take care. Thank you very much for joining us today. Bye.